a lot, Jim. That was really, you're an inspiration, Mr. Rhodes. You really are. So there's the old story where the preacher gets up to the microphone. It's not working, and he's going like, "Oh my gosh, there's something wrong with this microphone." And the congregation goes, "And also with you." I don't know if that would, did you actually do that on purpose, or that just, okay, so that was a God thing right there, apparently. Aren't we off to a great start this morning? This is just wonderful. All right, so anyhow, let's begin with, on page 6 in your bulletin, this is our 50-year member Sunday. This is always something to look forward to and get excited about. And so in recognition of our 50-year members, if you are one, of course, these are crosses from our Christian sisters and brothers in Christ in Bethlehem. And so they are olive wood. They have been made over there, handcrafted, and make sure that you get one. If you are a 50-year member, we invite you to please stand at this time and please be recognized. So 50-year members, please stand. Let us give them a warm St. Mark's thank you. And then you will see on page 7, this coming Saturday is our Chunk or Treat. We were in need of 15 vehicles. We had 14 at the 8 o'clock service. We had a family step up, so we have now reached our goal for 15 vehicles. We're very excited about that. But now then, let's establish a new goal, and that is, if you would like to help us surpass that goal, so that we would have at least 16 vehicles, that would be an absolutely tremendous thing. If you would like to bring your vehicle in and open up your trunk, and then the candies that have been collected over the last number of weeks would be distributed from the trunk of your vehicle. If you would like to volunteer to do that, we could have at least 16 or 17. We've never had that many before, and you'd like to be a champion for that, come talk to me afterwards. That would be a tremendous thing for us to experience. This year, we have two new features about Trunk or Treat. First, for those of you who parked in the north parking lot, you would have seen that we have a yard banner advertising. Nice big orange yard banner about our Trunk or Treat. And then secondly, instead of handing out the usual cards, we thought it was time to do something different. So we had magnets made up, and they really do look sharp. So we'll be handing magnets out. We thought that'd be more practical. That way people can put them on their refrigerator or somewhere in the house, and that just could be something that they look at someday and realize maybe we need to check that out. So magnets for this year, they really do look excellent. Well, this is the day that our Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. If you're a guest with us today, welcome. Hope we can see you again very, very soon. Let us prepare our hearts to worship our Lord. I invite you to please stand at this time, and let us join together in giving praise and thanksgiving to our God, hymn 881, Let All Things Now Living. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And let us pray. Sovereign God, you turn your greatness into goodness for all the peoples on earth. Shape us into willing servants of your kingdom, and make us desire always and only your will. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated. It is now time for Noah's Park Children's Church.
Before reading from the Bible, we seek the illumination of the Holy Spirit that we may come receptive to the life-giving word which comes to us both from reading and the proclamation of the scripture. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word is proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. The Old Testament lesson comes from the 53rd chapter of Isaiah. Surely he has borne our infirmities and carried away our diseases, yet we accounted him stricken, struck down by God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole, and by his bruises we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have all turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed, and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth, like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shears is silent, so did he not open his mouth. By a perversion of justice he was taken away. Who could have imagined his future? For he was cut off from the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people. They made his grave with the wicked and his tomb with the rich, although he had done no violence and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him with affliction. When you make his life an offering for sin, he shall see his offspring and shall prolong his days. Through him the will of the Lord shall prosper. Out of his anguish he shall see. He shall find satisfaction through his knowledge. The righteous one, my servant, shall make many righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will allot him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out himself to death and was numbered with transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. Please read with me responsively Psalm 91, found in your bulletin. Because you have made the Lord your refuge, the Most High, your dwelling place. For he will command his angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways. You will tread on the lion and the adder. The young lion and the serpent will trample underfoot.
Those who love me, I will deliver. I will protect those who know my name.
When they call to me, I will answer them. I will be with them in trouble. I will rescue them and honor them.
The long life will satisfy them and show them my salvation.
The New Testament lesson comes from the fifth chapter of Hebrews. Every high priest chosen from amongst mortals is put in charge of things pertaining to God on their behalf, to offer gifts and sacrifices for sins. He is able to deal gently with the ignorant and wayward, since he himself is subject to weaknesses, and because of this, he must offer sacrifice for his own sins as well as for those of the people. And one does not presume to take this honor, but takes it only when called by God, just as Aaron was. So also Christ did not glorify himself in becoming a high priest, but was appointed by the one who said to him, "You are my son. Today I have begotten you." As he says also in another place, "You are a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek." In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverent submission. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered, and having been made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him, having been designated by God a high priest according to the order of Melchizedek. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand. The good news of the Holy Gospel for you, God's people, as it is written in the Gospel according to St. Mark, the 10th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Now James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came forward to him and said to him, "Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask of you." And Jesus said to them, "What is it you want me to do for you?" And they said to him, "Appoint us to sit, one at your right hand and one at your left in your glory." But Jesus said to them, "You do not know what you are asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I drink or be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with?" And they replied, "We are able." And Jesus said to them, "The cup that I drink, you will drink. And with the baptism with which I am baptized, you will be baptized. But to sit at my right hand or at my left is not mine to appoint, but is for those for whom it has been prepared." Oh, when the 10 heard this, they began to be angry with James and John. So Jesus called them and said to them, "You know that among the Gentiles, those whom they recognize as their rulers lord it over them, and their great ones are tyrants over them. But it is not so among you. Instead, whoever wishes to become great among you must be your servant. Whoever wishes to be first among you must be slave of all. For the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." Word of God, word of life.
Praise,
And please be seated. And so grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ, the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Amen. So, what is your favorite title or nickname for Jesus? Is it Alpha and Omega? Is it Dayspring? Is it Bright Morning Star? Is it the Good Shepherd or Shepherd and Guardian of our souls? The Bread of Life, the Way, the Truth, and the Life, Author and Giver of Life? What is your favorite title or nickname for Jesus? Savior. Okay. Well, it was a rhetorical question, but thank you, Jim, for doing that anyways. You are really vocal today. You know that? So the statement that Jim said earlier during the announcements, it really just doesn't bear repeating, but you know, thank you. But we all have, or at least I would hope, or maybe you're on the journey of figuring out what just might be your favorite nickname or title that's associated with our Lord. But more than likely, the title or nickname of high priest is usually not high on the list of what comes to mind. And yet in our reading that Marilyn shared with us, it's page 3 in your bulletin from the New Testament reading of the book of Hebrews. There it is. Jesus is called our priest or our high priest, the eternal high priest who became the source of our eternal salvation. Now, we're continuing our series about 7-year week to understand that our life of faith isn't just for an hour or so on Sunday morning, but it's Sunday through Saturday, that this is something that we invest in throughout the week as well. So it's not 1-year week, it's 7-year week. And how we can deepen the roots of our faith and strengthen and develop and grow our faith in doing so. Now, what I shared last Sunday was that every time I step in the pulpit and when we come together to worship our Lord and gather as the people of God, that one of the purposes that I see in the pulpit ministry of your congregation is that I am here to help you get through the week. That based on God's word, what is it that our Lord has to share with us? And that to me, that is so much of what the gospel is and so much of what the pulpit ministry is about. That what is it in God's word that we have for that day that can get you, help you get through the week? But not just get through the week, but also to flourish, to thrive as well. That is what drives me when I get into the pulpit. And hopefully you can be benefactors of that. All of us can as such. So to take what we have in our reading today, and how is it that that can apply to our lives 7 days a week? But I will be the first to admit and to confess that what we have before us today is really heady stuff. It is a real challenge to put some traction on this and where the rubber hits the road, to put a set of wheels on what Jesus is saying about himself and to just let it fly. But let's hang in there together and try to accomplish this and see what we can do. Because to know that Jesus is the eternal high priest who became the source of our eternal salvation is what our reading from Hebrews says. Yeah, that can be pretty peculiar rhetoric. And what does that mean? And how, of all things, does that not only help you get through the week, but to thrive as well? And I'll be the first one to admit, and you just might be sitting there and thinking to yourself, and it's like, you know, Pastor, this stuff sounds like mush to me. I mean, I had a really tough week. Looking at my schedule, I know what kind of week I got coming, and it's going to be a tough one as well, and I just don't see it yet on what this has got to do with me. Or maybe you're sitting there going, you know, I'm not Roman Catholic, and here Jesus is talking about himself as being a priest. I'm really confused about this, and that just makes no sense. Or maybe you're just one who is sitting there and going, you know, this is kind of intriguing, so let's just see how this plays out, Pastor. And maybe, just maybe, somehow, some way, this will take my faith to the next level. So, I get it. So let's explore and see what we can discover. So we're going to talk about bridges. You may think, oh my gosh, he's now throwing us a curveball. If it wasn't confusing enough, Jesus as a high priest or high priest, now we're going to be talking about bridges. Hang in there with me, because there really is a point to all this. When you think of bridges, of course, there's the bridge in music. So for those of you who understand music theory or who are more musically inclined, you understand that most of the songs that you listen to on the radio, it will include a bridge. And the bridge is where there's a change in tempo or key signature or rhythm. And what it does, it connects one section of the song to another section of the song, but it sort of throws something a little bit different in there. And then this might be familiar territory for some of you. And that is, maybe you got a bust in the chops there, or you crashed your bicycle, or, you know, it just kind of can be part of the aging process as well, and you have some teeth missing, and so your dentist put a bridge in there to connect and fill that gap that maybe you have within your, your teeth. We'll just use that. And then there is this. In gymnastics and other athletics, this position is called the bridge. I just put it up there because that's what it's called. And when I look at it and I just think, well, I remember the days I could have done that, but now it just hurts to look at it. And then, of course, what most likely comes to mind when you think about bridges is this. Maybe you went over one to get here this morning. But I mean, you got your truss bridges, your cantilever, your beam, your suspension, all different types of bridges. Bridges are part of our life, our everyday life. And then there's this bridge that I want to show you that I think is really kind of odd and peculiar. And maybe you've never thought of it that way before, but this is one of the oldest bridges, probably the oldest bridge that's in existence in our world. And there it is. This bridge spans or connects the gap that exists between God and God's people. This bridge is known as Jesus and his cross. See, the word priest literally means mediator. In other words, that person that helps mend the broken relationship between God and his people. But the word priest also literally means bridge. And so when Jesus is calling himself the chief high priest, the Pontifex Maximus, as it would be in Latin, that he is the perfect eternal bridge that spans the gap between the Almighty and his fallen creation, you and I. That Jesus is the eternal, perfect, forever bridge is what he is describing himself as. So, let's get into a little bit more detail, all right? Because in the first four verses of our chapter from Hebrews today, it helps us understand that in the Old Testament ancient Israel, the high priest acted as the mediator, the bridge on behalf of the nation of Israel, by offering gifts and also offering animal sacrifices to God for the nation's sins. This was done most notably on the day known as the Day of Atonement or Yom Kippur. It's in the Torah, or in other words, the first five books of the Bible, the book of Leviticus. But there is a problem with this system. Actually, three. That one, the high priest was also a sinful person who offered gifts and sacrifice, not just on behalf of the people, but also himself as well. Which means that the high priest then was an imperfect or substandard mediator and bridge between God and God's people, and that was limited by his own weakness, which then also meant that the sacrifices offered to God had to be repeated over and over and over again, century after century after century after century. So maybe you're at this point now going, well, that's all well and good, Pastor. You know, talking about repeated animal sacrifices for centuries, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years. Sometimes I do that accidentally in my grill when I'm cooking hamburgers. I don't know if there's a difference with that or not. But, you know, these animal sacrifices of 3,000 years ago, what's that got to do with me on October 20th of 2024? That's a good question. So I get it. Just stay with me a little bit longer. Because the author of Hebrews, inspired by God's Spirit, reminds us in the remaining verses of today's passage that unlike ancient Israel's high priest, Jesus, as your high priest, as your mediator, as your bridge between God and you, is the divinely chosen, eternal Son of God, who is perfect and without sin. Not an imperfect high priest who is with sin and serves for decades and then passes away, but is the perfect high priest, the perfect mediator, the perfect bridge forever, forever, transcending human limitations in a way no human priest ever could. So what does that mean for you? It's Tuesday afternoon, and you're tired, and you want to go home, and it's been a hard day, and maybe home just isn't all that relaxing either. You know what's coming on the horizon and what you got to be dealing with the next day. But what we hear in this so far about Jesus as your bridge, as your high priest, the chief priest, is that through him, you can have a close relationship with God, where Christ perfectly intercedes for you. In other words, that with your creator and owner of heaven and earth, because of Christ, you've got direct access. No busy signal, no phone block, no put on hold, no roadblocks, no separation. But rather, you have an advocate who stands up for you and is willing to close the gap and bridge the gap and to intercede on your behalf. And then as our high priest, he does not offer animal sacrifices to God because he himself is the once and for all sacrifice to God, our crucified and risen Lord. See, Jesus paid a debt he did not owe because we owed a debt we could not pay. One of my favorite stories to share to help understand this a little bit further is that there was a man who worked in a small town as the operator of a drawbridge, as we talk about bridges. A train track ran across this bridge, and the operator's job was to keep the bridge up so that the boats would be able to pass through on the river below. But when a train approached, he was to blow the whistle and let down the bridge. Well, one sunny Saturday morning, he brought his 7-year-old son along with him, and the boy was able to frolic along the river and skip rocks on the water and chase butterflies and catch fish. Now, on this day, shortly before noon, a passenger train was due to come through. So the man began to make preparations with the bridge to let it down so that the train could pass safely across the river. But as he examined the bridge and getting ready to making his preparations and knowing the train was coming, he looked down there and realized that there was a small child, a young child, who was playing in the bridge area, somehow had climbed over the guardrail and playing on the very spot where the bridge would come down. Much to his horror, he realized that that child was his son. And he yelled out his son's name, the boy's name, but the child could not hear because the sound of the oncoming train just drowned it out, and he had to make a quick decision. He would either lower the bridge now and his son would die, or if he didn't lower the bridge, plunged into the river. He had barely a second to decide what to do. So in pure agony, he threw the lever forward, lowered the bridge, the train crossed, and his son died. And as the train passed by, people just smiled and waved, oblivious as to what sacrifice was made on their behalf for their safety and well-being. This is what God has done for you and for me and for all people. And because of that great sacrifice that was made, your ultimate future is secure in God as we are baptized believers and followers of our Lord Jesus. And it helps us understand that you do not have to earn your salvation. So for those of you who are workaholics, this is either good news or it's bad news for you. Because you can't earn it, you can't work for it, you can't buy it. Because your salvation has already been purchased. It cost Christ everything so that you may have that security with our Lord forever. And because of what Jesus has done for you as your bridge, as your chief priest, what it also tells us is you do not have to prove your worth. So for those of you who have a very, very poor self-esteem, or for those of you who are perfectionists and have to just, you gotta prove it over and over and over again, this is one area, at least in your life, you don't have to play that game. Because of what Christ has done for you, and as you are sealed with the Holy Spirit and marked with the cross of Christ forever, you don't have to prove your worth. Because you're already deemed worthy in what he has done for you. But if that isn't enough, as we wrap this up, Jesus, who is the perfect eternal high priest, the perfect eternal bridge, who is the without sin Son of God, also learned obedience. And this is where we get to see more of the human side of this priest. That through the school of hard knocks, as we would call it, Jesus learned obedience, as it says in verse 8. Resulting in him becoming the source of our eternal salvation for those who obey him. If you are looking for an example to follow, a pattern of which to pattern your life by, then this is what is offered to us today. We all have role models that we like to admire and that we like to model our life after. This is the perfect one, the eternal one, the supreme one above all. It's through his hardship that he learned humility, empathy, and compassion, as hopefully do we as well. The Apostle Paul wrote it this way in the second chapter to the Philippians. It says, in your relationship with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage, but rather he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, the incarnation, in other words, God made flesh, the Word made flesh, Christmas, that's the great miracle of Christmas, that Jesus is fully divine and fully human. He humbled himself by becoming obedient unto death, even death on a cross. And as such, in learning obedience, we hear this about our Savior as well in the verses just prior to our reading for today. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way just as we are, yet he did not sin. So Jesus understands our struggles, and it is through Christ that our God, our Creator, understands what it is like to be human and the struggles and difficulties that we go with and experience. Is it a new insight to be able to say, life often doesn't go as planned? I think we can all pretty much go, yeah, life often does not go as planned. And so we hear these words as we close out for today, and hopefully 7 our week, taking this and how it can apply 7 days a week to us. As Paul writes in 2 Corinthians, you know, we have this good news, this gospel that we've been talking about, this treasure in clays of jar, to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us. We are hard-pressed. When you hear these words, see if any of them just really, oh yeah, that's me, definitely. We are hard-pressed on every side. But because of this treasure, the good news, even when we can be at the end of our rope, we're not crushed. Perplexed, overwhelmed, confused, but not in despair. Persecuted, some people just really getting all over you and on your back, but not abandoned. Struck down, but not destroyed. Kind of the old, you get knocked down 7 times, you get up 8. We always carry around in our body the death of Jesus so that the life of Jesus may also be revealed in our body. For we who are alive are always being given over to death for Jesus' sake, so that his life may also be revealed. You may call him Savior, God, Lord. You may call him author and giver of life, bread of life, way, truth, and the life. You may have that favorite nickname, title for Jesus. Most likely, high priest, chief priest, isn't exactly high on the list. But yet it is such a powerful term that is described of our Lord, that he is indeed your eternal, perfect Son of God in the flesh, bridge that spans the gap between our almighty God and you, that we can always have access and intimacy and security of our ultimate future in him. Yeshua, Jesus, our Pontifex Maximus, our High Priest. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us rejoice in our Lord, hymn 692, We Are an Offering. Please stand.
Thank you.
Together we turn to page 105 in the front of our hymnals, page 105, and with the whole church, let us confess our ancient future faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. For the whole people of God in Christ Jesus, let us pray for the church, those in need, and for all of God's creation. Lord, this morning we intercede and pray on behalf of Jean Wilson, Ron Stein, Tracy Whitcraft, for Kenny Doner, Brent Stripe, Tony and Allie Springer and Jay, for Rhonda Stringfield, Brindley Davis, Josh Felver, and Nathan Frank. Pray, Lord, for peace in the Holy Land and throughout your creation as we pray for our nation as well. For our quilts and rice kits and helping those in our country affected by recent hurricane floodings, we lift them up to you and pray for those families, businesses, churches, and schools that have been affected. We ask, Lord, for a good and safe harvest season, and we are grateful for our 50-year members and their ministry as the hands and feet of Jesus. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, gracious God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always.
Also with you.
Let us share our Lord's peace with those around you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
We turn to page 109. On the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks and broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We turn to page 112, and Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Please be seated. If you're partaking of pew communion, I invite you to get your communion kits out at this time. The body of Christ given for you, and the blood of Christ shed for you. The body of Christ given for you.
Thank you.
Our Generosity Sunday is going to be next Sunday, along with Reformation Sunday and First Communion Sunday. We have a big day next week. Stan Weldy, if you'd please come forward as we ramp up for our Generosity Faith in Action. Stan, if you please.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Today's story of faith in action is written by our Synod Bishop, Reverend Daniel Bowden. God has a mission, and God's mission has a church. And God's church is full of generous people who have abundant gifts and resources. Gifts and resources that we are called to share. In the book of Acts, Jesus reminds us that it is more blessed to give than to receive. The spiritual practice of generosity is at the heart of following Jesus. One of my favorite Bible verses related to generosity is recorded in the Sermon on the Mount. The Bible verse is Matthew 6:21, "For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." This powerful verse reminds us that the spiritual practice of generosity can transform our hearts and lives, and at the same time, renew our parishes and communities. One of the best places to begin the practice of generosity is by being generous with ourselves. Too often, we pile loads of pressure and great expectations upon ourselves. We carry burdens that God never intended us for us to bear. Let's set aside the pressure and expectations as we learn to be gentle and generous with ourselves and with others. I like how Martin Luther explains the meaning of the eighth commandment. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. What does this mean? We are to fear and love God so that we do not tell lies about our neighbors, betray or slander them, or destroy their reputations. Instead, we are to come to their defense, speak well of them, and interpret everything they do in the best possible light. Think about how our parishes, communities, and world would be if we extended the practice of generosity to others by interpreting their words and deeds in the best possible light. By practicing generosity, we are given the opportunity to partner with God to renew all things. This partnership is at the heart of the Northwestern Ohio Synod's mission. Sent by the crucified and risen Jesus to make disciples, equip leaders, strengthen parishes, and nurture new communities for the renewal of Northwestern Ohio and the world. Thank you, congregation, for your commitment to Jesus through the spiritual practice of generosity.
Fifty-year members, a reminder, please stay here in the sanctuary after worship so we have your picture taken up front. We would greatly appreciate that. I invite you to stand, please. For the week to come, may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and grant you his peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace. Serve the Lord. Our sending hymn is in your bulletin inserts. Bring forth the kingdom.